Welcome to the FixSleep Bedtime Stories Channel, your sanctuary for relaxation, meditation, and a peaceful sleep. Immerse yourself in the soothing embrace of sleep-inducing tales, carefully crafted to transport you to mysterious lands. Let the gentle rain and serene sounds of nature accompany you on this journey to relaxation. Say goodbye to restless nights and welcome the embrace of a restful sleep with our magical sleep stories. So, let the tale begin. The Knight and the Cursed Queen. Chapter 1. The Enchanted Quest Begins. In the farthest reaches of the known world, beyond the bustling cities and over the rolling hills, lay the kingdom of Eldoria. It was a land shrouded in the mysteries of old, its history woven with tales of magic, heroism, and ancient curses. Here, the solemn castle of King Aldric stood as a testament to centuries of prosperity and peace. However, peace was but a fragile veil, for the queen had been cursed and transformed into a terrifying beast that roamed the castle grounds under the moon's cold gaze. Sir Cedric of Locksley, the kingdom's most esteemed knight, was summoned to the king's presence on a stormy night. The great hall of the castle, with its towering ceilings and flickering torches, echoed with the urgency of the matter at hand. King Aldric, a ruler of considerable wisdom and sorrow, presented Sir Cedric with a quest of unparalleled importance to break the curse that had befallen Queen Eleanor. The curse's origin was as mysterious as it was sudden. One evening, under a blood-red moon, the queen had vanished only to return as something otherworldly, her humanity obscured beneath layers of fur and ferocity. The castle's scholars and mages had toiled over ancient tomes and spells to no avail, leaving the kingdom in despair. Sir Cedric, known for his valor and unwavering spirit, accepted the quest without hesitation. His journey would begin at the Castle of Whispers, an ancient fortress abandoned at the edge of the kingdom. It was rumored that the castle held secrets crucial to unraveling the queen's curse. As dawn broke, casting a golden light over the kingdom, Sir Cedric set out, his armor gleaming and his resolve firm. The path to the Castle of Whispers wound through the enchanted forest, a vast expanse of ancient trees whose branches twisted into the sky, casting deep shadows. The forest was alive with whispers, not of wind through leaves, but of voices speaking in forgotten tongues. They told tales of lost travelers, ancient battles, and hidden treasures. Sir Cedric, guided by the whispered hints of the path ahead, navigated the forest's deceptive calm. After 3 days' journey, the silhouette of the Castle of Whispers appeared on the horizon. It stood on a cliff overlooking the Sea of Shadows, its turrets jagged against the sky like broken teeth. The castle was enveloped in a thick mist that seemed to pulse with a life of its own. Crossing the ancient drawbridge, Sir Cedric felt a chill that went beyond the cold air. It was as if the castle itself was sizing him up, considering whether he was worthy of the secrets it held. Inside, the castle was a labyrinth of corridors and chambers, each more mysterious than the last. Statues with eyes that seemed to follow his every move lined the hallways, and tapestries depicting the kingdom's darker legends fluttered as if stirred by an unseen breeze. Sir Cedric's footsteps echoed on the stone floors, a solitary sound in the oppressive silence that hung over the castle. The heart of the Castle of Whispers was its grand library, a vast room filled with shelves that stretched into the shadows, laden with books and scrolls of unimaginable age. The air was thick with the scent of old parchment and forgotten magic. It was here that Sir Cedric found the first clue, a dusty tome bound in leather, its cover embossed with a sigil that mirrored the pendant Queen Eleanor had worn on the day of her transformation. The book was written in an ancient script that twisted across the pages like vines. With patience and determination, Sir Cedric deciphered the text, which spoke of a rare alignment of the stars under which certain powerful curses could be cast or reversed. The tome suggested that the queen's curse could be linked to such an event, but breaking it would require more than just knowledge of the stars. It would necessitate a journey across the cursed realms to gather magical components powerful enough to confront and undo the dark magic at work. With the castle beginning to reveal its secrets, Sir Cedric felt the weight of the task ahead. Each clue led deeper into the realm of the mystical and the unknown. Yet, driven by duty and the memory of Queen Eleanor's kind rule, he prepared to delve further into the mysteries of the enchanted lands. As night fell, casting long shadows through the broken windows of the castle, Sir Cedric set up a small camp in the library. Surrounded by ancient wisdom, he planned his next moves. The journey would take him to the River of Reflections, where truths were unveiled in the shimmering depths, and to the Forest of Forgotten Spells, where magic ran as wild as the foliage. Resting his sword by his side, Sir Cedric looked over the maps and scrolls he had gathered. His quest was clear, his resolve unwavering. He knew the road ahead would be fraught with peril, but the fate of Queen Eleanor and the future of Eldoria rested upon his shoulders. As the fire in his makeshift camp crackled and cast eerie shadows on the stone walls, he mulled over the ancient tome's warnings and prophecies. Chapter 2, The River of Reflections. After leaving the enigmatic Castle of Whispers, with its haunting echoes and secrets, Sir Cedric rode toward the River of Reflections. The journey was long and fraught with uncertainty, for the path lay through dense, uncharted woodlands known as the Whispering Thickets, where the leaves seemed to murmur secrets and the wind sang mournful tunes. Sir Cedric, ever vigilant, pressed forward, driven by his mission to undo the curse that bound his queen. As he approached the vicinity of the river, the forest gradually opened up to reveal the expansive River of Reflections. It was a broad and serene waterway that mirrored the sky above so perfectly that it was often difficult to tell where the river ended and the heavens began. Legend had it that the river not only reflected one's physical appearance, but also one's innermost truths and desires, a trait that made it both revered and feared by those who knew of its powers. Sir Cedric dismounted near the bank, leading his horse to drink from the waters that were said to be as clear as crystal and as deep as ancient wisdom. He gazed into the water, and instead of seeing his own reflection, he saw the myriad of lives he had touched, the battles he had fought, and shadows of what was yet to come. The river did not simply show images. It weaved them with emotions, making each reflection a poignant echo of the viewer's soul. As the night watched, the waters began to churn, and the images shifted, revealing a scene of the queen in her royal chamber before her transformation. Sir Cedric watched intently as the reflection showed her opening a forbidden tome. A look of dread and curiosity mingled on her face. The air around her shimmered with the magic that soon enveloped her, twisting her form into that of a beast. The scene was so vivid that Sir Cedric felt he could reach out and alter the past, but he knew it was but a mere reflection of what had been. Shaken but enlightened by the vision, Sir Cedric scooped up some of the river water into a crystal vial, an artifact he had been given by a wise old sorceress from his village. The water continued to swirl with luminescent colors, capturing the essence of the revelations it had just displayed. With the vial securely fastened, he prepared to leave, but the river was not done with him yet. As he turned to retrieve his horse, the waters parted, and from the depths arose a figure clad in robes of shimmering water silk, her hair flowing like liquid moonlight. She was the guardian of the river, a spirit of water and wisdom, long spoken of in the whispers of the old. Her eyes were deep pools of knowledge, her gaze piercing yet serene. "Knight of Locksley," she addressed Sir Cedric, with a voice that rippled like the river itself. "You seek to break a curse most foul, one that has entangled the fate of your queen with the dark tapestries of magic long forbidden." Sir Cedric bowed respectfully, aware of the power the guardian wielded over the domain he trespassed. "Yes, great guardian, I seek your guidance and any aid you can offer to free my queen from her tormented form." The guardian considered him for a moment, her gaze unflinching. "The path you tread is fraught with peril, much like the turbulent waters of this river. You will face truths that may shake the foundations of your soul. But remember, not all reflections are to be feared. Some are to be embraced." With those cryptic words, she reached into the folds of her robe and produced a small orb, glowing with an inner light. "Take this orb of Lysere," she said as she handed it to him. "It has the power to reveal the hidden, to illuminate the darkened paths you must walk. Use it wisely, for its truths are not always easy to behold." Grateful for the gift, Sir Cedric thanked the guardian, who merely nodded and slowly descended back into the river, her form dissipating like a mist until only the gentle flow of the water remained. Clutching the orb and the vial of enchanted water, Sir Cedric felt a renewed sense of purpose. The tools given to him were symbols of hope, not only for Queen Eleanor, but for the entire kingdom of Eldoria, shadowed as it was by her curse. Mounting his horse, Sir Cedric took one last look at the placid surface of the River of Reflections. The waters had returned to their tranquil state, reflecting the setting sun's golden hues. The journey ahead was unclear, and dangers lurked in the shadows of the unknown. But Sir Cedric felt prepared. The river had shown him much, and with the guardian's gifts, he was ready to face whatever lay ahead in the cursed realms. With the River of Reflections behind him, Sir Cedric set his sights on the Forest of Forgotten Spells, the next crucial destination in his quest. The forest was rumored to be a place where time did not flow as it should, where magic was as common as the leaves on trees, and where the very air thrummed with the power of ancient spells. As night began to fall, casting long shadows across his path, Sir Cedric rode on, the orb of Lysere glowing softly in his pack, a beacon of light guiding him through the darkness. Chapter 3, The Forest of Forgotten Spells. after the enlightening yet eerie encounter at the River of Reflections, Sir Cedric rode with renewed determination toward the Forest of Forgotten Spells. Legend spoke of this forest not just as a mere stretch of woodland, but as a living entity, ancient and imbued with a consciousness shaped by centuries of magic. It was a place where forgotten spells lingered like morning mist, waiting for the unwary or the worthy to ensnare or enlighten. As Sir Cedric approached the forest's edge, the atmosphere thickened, and a palpable sense of magic permeated the air. The trees stood tall and imposing, their trunks twisted into fantastical shapes, their branches entwining to form archways that seemed to beckon him deeper into their midst. With each step his horse took, the sounds of the outside world faded, until all that remained was the eerie silence of the forest and the soft thud of hooves on the leaf-strewn path. The deeper Sir Cedric ventured, the more the forest seemed to awaken. Whispers filled the air, not of wind through leaves, but of voices long silenced, murmuring incantations that made the air shimmer and the ground pulse. Each whisper was a remnant of a spell cast long ago, their purposes as varied as the mages who had uttered them. Some were benign, meant to protect or heal, while others were darker, woven with threads of malice and despair. Navigating this labyrinthine forest required more than a keen sense of direction. It required an intuition for the arcane. Sir Cedric found his path occasionally blocked by barriers unseen, which dissolved only when he recited counterspells he had hastily learned from the tome he had found in the Castle of Whispers. Each successful incantation earned him passage deeper into the forest's heart, where the spells grew denser and more potent. The heart of the Forest of Forgotten Spells was known as the Glen of Echoes, a clearing where it was said the most powerful magic of the forest was concentrated. It was here that the old witch, keeper of the forest's deepest secrets, made her home. Her abode was not made of wood or stone, but of living vines and flowers, continuously growing and reshaping itself according to her will. Sir Cedric dismounted and approached the witch's dwelling with caution. As he stepped into the clearing, the air grew thick with the scent of herbs and the heady aroma of blooming flowers. The witch, sensing his presence, emerged from her floral haven. She was as much a part of the forest as the trees themselves, her eyes gleaming with a mixture of curiosity and power. "You have traveled far, Knight of the Realm," she said, her voice carrying the lilting tones of the forest itself. "What brings you to the heart of my domain?" Sir Cedric bowed respectfully. "Great witch, I seek your wisdom to lift a curse that has befallen my queen. She has been transformed into a beast, and none in my kingdom possess the knowledge to restore her." The witch studied him for a long moment, her gaze piercing through to his very soul. Finally, she nodded. "I will help you, for your heart is true, and your cause is just. But the path to breaking your queen's curse is fraught with peril, and the price may be greater than you expect." Willing to pay any price, Sir Cedric agreed. The witch led him to the center of the Glen of Echoes, where an ancient altar stood, covered in runes that glowed with an ethereal light. "Here, in the oldest part of the forest, the magic is strongest," she explained. "To break your queen's curse, you must conjure a potion of powerful regents, the essence of dawn, which you have already acquired, a tear of a phoenix, and the heart of a living shadow." The tasks were daunting, but Sir Cedric accepted each with a nod, his resolve unwavering. The witch provided him with a map that showed the locations where these ingredients could be found, each marked by trials of courage, wisdom, and sacrifice. First, Sir Cedric sought the phoenix, a creature of fire and rebirth, whose tears could heal even the deepest wounds. He found the phoenix atop the fiery mount, a volcano whose rivers of lava provided the perfect home for such a creature. The battle to obtain a single tear was fierce, testing Sir Cedric's bravery and resilience. Next, he ventured into the Shadow Vale, a place where light seemed to fear to tread. Here, shadows lived as creatures, their forms fluid and elusive. Capturing the heart of a living shadow was a test of his wisdom and cunning as he navigated the deceptive terrain, where every step could be a trap. With all ingredients in hand, Sir Cedric returned to the Glen of Echoes. The witch, impressed by his success, prepared the potion under the light of the full moon, chanting spells older than the forest itself. As the potion simmered, its fumes sparkled with all the colors of the dawn. "Drink this," the witch instructed, once the concoction was ready, handing Sir Cedric a chalice filled with the luminescent liquid. "It will protect you from the final trial, the confrontation with the beast your queen has become. Only with your heart shielded by this potion can you face her and survive." Grateful and determined, Sir Cedric drank deeply. The potion was sweet and filled him with a warmth that coursed through his veins like liquid courage. Armed with the witch's blessings and the magical protections of the potion, Sir Cedric set out to return to his kingdom, ready to face the beastly queen and restore her to her true form. The forest seemed to acknowledge his newfound power, the path clearing as he walked, the whispers of the spells encouraging him onward. The knight felt the weight of his quest, but also the hope that the end was near, and with it, the restoration of his queen and the salvation of his kingdom. Chapter 4, The Final Confrontation. With the mystical potion coursing through his veins, Sir Cedric returned to the kingdom of Eldoria, the weight of his quest pressing upon him. The castle grounds, once vibrant and bustling, now lay under a shadow of quiet dread, the curse palpable in the air as the queen, transformed into a fearsome beast, roamed the once sacred gardens. The castle walls, stained with the melancholy of the kingdom's plight, stood silent, witnesses to the turmoil that had befallen the royal family. The sky was streaked with the crimson hues of sunset as Sir Cedric approached the gardens where the beast was last seen. The once beautiful gardens had grown wild, their beauty twisted into something out of a dark fairy tale. Thorny vines crept over the paths, and flowers bloomed in unnaturally vibrant colors, as if reflecting the chaos of the curse. The air was heavy, with a mix of floral scents and the musky odor of the beast. As he stepped cautiously along the overgrown paths, Sir Cedric's hand rested on the hilt of his sword. Though he knew well that physical weapons would likely be of little use against such magic, his true reliance lay in the witch's potion and the orb of Lysere, glowing softly within his cloak, its light a comforting presence against the encroaching darkness. Suddenly, the beast emerged from behind a twisted grove of trees. It was both magnificent and terrifying, covered in dark fur, with eyes that glowed a fierce golden hue. Its form was both human and animal, a heartbreaking reminder of the queen it once was. The beast snarled, its sound a mix of rage and pain, as it recognized the presence of a human in its midst. "Your Majesty," Sir Cedric called out, his voice steady despite the pounding of his heart. "I have come to free you from this curse, to restore you to your true self." The beast paused, tilting its head as if struggling with a distant memory. Sir Cedric slowly reached into his cloak and drew out the orb of Lyser. The orb's light intensified, casting a beam that enveloped the beast in a soft, radiant glow. The air trembled with power as ancient spells woven into the light began to work their magic. Sir Cedric continued, his voice imbued with all the hope he could muster. "I have journeyed through the river of reflections, sought wisdom in the forest of forgotten spells, and have been granted aid by powers old and wise. Please, let this be the end of your suffering." The beast's growls subsided into confused whimpers, its eyes softening as the light from the orb seemed to penetrate the darkness that had enveloped its soul. Slowly, it approached Sir Cedric, the ground beneath its heavy paws trembling with each step. The knight held the orb higher, and as he did, he began to recite the incantations the old witch had taught him, words that were ancient and powerful, meant to heal and reveal. The garden around them responded, the wind picking up, swirling leaves and petals in a dance around them, like spirits called to witness the ritual. Then, Sir Cedric took the vial containing the last of the potion and poured it at the feet of the beast. The potion's magic seeped into the earth, a bright light spreading rapidly beneath them. The beast howled, a sound that tore at the night, and then it began to change. Before Sir Cedric's eyes, the beast's form shrank, the fur receded, and the monstrous features softened. The transformation was both beautiful and agonizing to watch, as bones realigned and fur gave way to skin. Where the beast had stood, there now knelt a figure, shivering and vulnerable. Queen Eleanor restored. Tears filled Sir Cedric's eyes as he rushed to her side, draping his cloak around her shoulders. The queen looked up at him, her eyes filled with tears of gratitude and the pain of remembrance. "You have freed me," she whispered, her voice hoarse from disuse. "Yes, my queen," Sir Cedric replied, helping her to stand. "The kingdom has awaited your return." The transformation's magic radiated outwards, the garden beginning to right itself, the twisted plants receding and blooming anew in the night air. The curse was lifted, not only from the queen, but from the land itself. As they walked back to the castle, the royal guards and servants who had hidden in fear came forward, their joyous cries filling the air as they saw their queen returned to them. The king, who had watched from a balcony, rushed down, his relief palpable as he embraced his wife. The kingdom celebrated for days, the air filled with music and laughter, the shadows of the curse finally dispelled. Sir Cedric was honored as the hero of Eldoria, though he remained humble, knowing that it was not his actions alone, but the courage and strength of many that had lifted the darkness. As peace returned to Eldoria, Sir Cedric often walked the restored gardens with Queen Eleanor, discussing plans for the future and the lessons of the past. The queen, though forever marked by her ordeal, ruled with a new wisdom, a leader shaped by the trials she had endured and overcome. And so, the tale of Sir Cedric and the royal beast became a legend, a story of courage, transformation, and the enduring power of hope and redemption.